morning and welcome to our service of morning worship today. A special welcome to you if you're joining us from your home, either at the same time as we are here or at some time later today or during the week. We gather this morning in shock and sadness following the tragic news of our dear sister Michelle's death on Wednesday. We will be thanking God for her life and remembering her family in our prayers later in our service. But let us spend a few moments now, calling to mind our memories of Michelle in happier times. Lord God, we thank you for the life we shared with Michelle as a church family, and we pray for all today who are grieving for her. We especially remember her family, and we pray for your comforting arms to surround them. We know that nothing can separate us from your love and from the love you have for Michelle, and we commit her to you to rest in your peace. Amen. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Give us the joy of your saving help, and sustain us with your life-giving Spirit. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. The music group are going to lead us in singing the song, The Servant King. And we are allowed to sing today. Behind our masks, we can join in if we would like to.
Served but to serve.
come to our time of confession. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. We say together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As God's forgiven people, we say the thanksgiving together. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you most humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and all humankind. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and the hope of glory. Give us, we pray, such a sense of all your mercies that our hearts may be sincerely thankful, so that we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honour and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now we sing the song, The Law of the Lord.
Let us the glory of the Lord.
Chris and Jenny are now going to bring us our readings, after which Brian will be speaking to us.
A reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 to 15. Paul writes, "But we have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our bodies. For while we live, we are always being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be made visible in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. But just as we have the same spirit of faith that is in accordance with Scripture, I believed and so I spoke, we also believe and so we speak. Because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God." This is the word of the Lord.
Our second reading is taken from Matthew chapter 20, verses 20 to 28. The request of the mother of James and John. Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came to him with her sons, and kneeling before him, she asked a favor of him. And he said to her, "What do you want?" She said to him, "Declare that these two sons of mine will sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your kingdom." But Jesus answered, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am about to drink?" They said to him, "We are able." He said to them, "You will indeed drink my cup, but to sit at my right hand and at my left, this is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father." When the 10 heard it, they were angry with the two brothers. But Jesus called them to him and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. It will not be so among you, but whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Father, we pray that you would show us your light, that we may be filled with your light. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I have to confess to something that some of you may disagree with. I like Spike Milligan's quirky sense of humour. A couple of years ago, our men's walking group paid homage at his grave in Winchelsea. Among his wonderful sayings were these. Said Hamlet to Ophelia, "I'll draw a sketch of thee. What kind of pencil shall I use? To be or not to be?" Another one was, "Blessed are the cracked, for they let in the light. More about that one later. Now, you'll know that I've come lately to the warmth of the Anglican fold from the nonconformist cold. Well, that's how some see it. One of the things that I've had to review is my understanding of the saints. Not only remembering and recognizing saints' days, but more importantly, what they mean to us. Sure, Baptists and Methodists, other nonconformists, had their saints, heroes of the faith, people like the Wesley family, George Muller, missionaries like C.T. Studd or William Carey, and so on. And we're in danger of treating them in the same way as the more traditional established saints, not simply as people to learn from, but people who are somehow different from us, are much better than us. Where the truth of the matter is that they're saints not because they were better but or different, but because they were the same as us, with successes and failures, character strengths and weaknesses, just like you and me. The best of men are men at best. What made any of these ordinary people saints is the work of the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit at work in us as in them. And that's something that we so often forget. Paul is telling the Christians at Corinth much the same in this passage. He's been outlining his ministry that God has given him and his team, setting forth the truth of the good news of Jesus, shining a light in the pagan darkness of lives without God. But far from elevating himself into some kind of pillar, he says, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay, earthen vessels, to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us." Paul says that he is hewn from the same clay as the rest of us. And he doesn't just have feet of clay, he is simply a clay pot. And again through his letters, he goes to lengths to emphasize this. Indeed, he says that it's all the better that he's an ordinary clay pot, so that God's message should surprise people all the more and not distract them by Paul's skills or eloquence. Paul wants people to see Jesus, not Paul. Before following Jesus, he had the name Saul, the name of Israel's first king, the man who was head and shoulders above everyone else. As he set out to serve Jesus, he took the name Paul, which means little one. He recognized that he was no longer the big shot. He was simply a Paul, one of Jesus' own little ones. Nothing more than a clay pot with all its weaknesses and fragilities. He talks in this passage about being afflicted, perplexed, persecuted, struck down, indeed given over to death, and carrying around in his body the death of Jesus. We have become weak and vulnerable, just like you. Paul talks quite a bit in his letters about the work that Jesus does in us to make this clay pot fit for the master's use and ready for glory. He uses particularly two theological words, justification, or being justified, and sanctification, or being sanctified. Let me explain just briefly. Justification is something that Jesus does in us to which we have very little to contribute. In fact, The fact that we need to be justified is because we can't contribute anything. Augustus Toplady wrote a hymn, Rock of Ages, in which he says, "Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling." To be justified means I am treated just as if I'd never sinned, even though I have sinned and do sin. As Paul says, the good I want to do, I don't do, and the evil I don't want to do, that I do. Which he then follows by saying, but thanks be to God for the victory that is in Christ Jesus. It is Jesus who's made the difference. It's Jesus by his death in my place and his resurrection, which I take as my own. He's changed my status from rebel against God into a child of God, even though my state is still that of a sinner. I'm a sinner, but saved by grace, God's undeserved mercy. I'm still a clay pot and always will be, but my ownership has changed. That's justification. Sanctification is a process by which I'm becoming more like what I have been reborn as, a child of God. It's a partnership between me and the God Spirit in me. Though I must say that my experience shows that any progress is much more to do with God's Spirit at work than my responsiveness. It's a lifelong work, and the essential thing is that I don't cease to be a clay pot, and it doesn't make the clay pot any less cracked. Many people seem to think that God will make us his children only if we're sanctified, if we're living a better life, earning our place. No. Justification by his grace comes first. And when we've stopped trying to struggle to be better, then the lifelong work of sanctification begins. In that sense, we're all aspiring saints. So Paul says here, I'm still made of the same earthen clay as you. I'm an ordinary little one just like you, and I have the same treasure in me as is in you. I'm justified, and I'm being sanctified, all by the work of God's Holy Spirit. Now, in this letter, he's also, just a few verses before our reading, reminded us that God's first creative action, letting light shine out of darkness. That same God has made his light shine in our hearts, he says, to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. And his next sentence then is to say, that this treasure is in jars of clay. Now that may well be a reference to a common practice that they'd have been used to. If a pot was made and was cracked or broken or came out of the kiln too thin or with a fault, it might not be broken up and discarded immediately. Instead, it might be used as a hanger for a lamp. And the lamp was put inside, and the light shone out of the thin places, the flaws, and the cracks. By putting these two images together, the light, the treasure in our hearts, and the earthen pots, he seems to be saying, we're all flawed, we're all cracked, but the light of the gospel of Jesus shines out through those flaws and those cracks. So God's work in us is a lifelong work. And you don't cease to be a clay pot. And the clay pot is probably no less cracked. But what's inside gets brighter. So we've looked at the earthen pots. Let's take a look at the treasure that makes the difference. Our gospel reading shows us two flawed disciples. Indeed, all the disciples show that they're all formed of the same heap of clay. James and John's mother thinks her sons deserve a special place in Jesus' kingdom. 10 out of 10 for her love for her sons. 10 out of 10 for her appreciation of Jesus as king. Minus several hundred for failing to appreciate the nature of that kingdom after all this time. Their treasure is status, position, ambition, and power. But ambition for position and earthly status has no place in this kingdom. The only throne is a cross. The only authority is that of a servant. They had in mind different treasure. A treasure of this world that doesn't last. A treasure that can't satisfy. Spike Milligan did say, "All I ask is the chance to prove that money can't make me happy." James and John and their mum had their eye on the treasures of tangible earth. Jesus' promise is for the indefinable treasures of heaven, those we just get a sneak preview of here, like the work of God's Spirit in us, His love, His peace, His faithfulness, grace, things that can't be measured or valued by a bank or counted in a stockroom. Solid joys and lasting treasure, as the hymn writer put it. They involve giving away instead of acquiring, sacrifice instead of grasping. But they last, and they spread, and they bring with them such great treasure. Paul talks about truth and God's light in the heart, the work of God's Spirit within. These were the treasures he now valued, and for which he counted everything else as rubbish. His old career was rubbish. His ambition was rubbish. His comfy life was rubbish. His status as a respected Jewish rabbi was rubbish. Even his Jewish pedigree he thought in terms of as rubbish compared with the treasure of knowing Christ. And what does this treasure do in us? Well, this passage is all about the victory that is in Jesus, the treasure within. We have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and not from us. We're afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted but not forsaken, struck down but not destroyed, always carrying the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in us. We're always being given up to death for Jesus so that Jesus' life may be made visible in our mortal flesh. Jesus once told a story that should appeal to any detectorist with an eye to a fortune, about a man who found buried treasure. It would probably have been buried in a clay pot and forgotten over generations. But he found it. He reburied it and sold everything he had and bought the field to possess it. Jesus tells us that the treasure of the kingship of Jesus in our lives is worth selling everything else. And Paul lived this out. He and you and me will still be an earthen pot, still a humble and cracked pot. And there'll be a treasure within, a treasure that surpasses the value beyond anything this world can afford. And that is what people will see. Not the cracked pot, but the treasure within shining out. I asked for our next song to be sung. The group won't be singing it. I asked my son-in-law, Jonathan Rea, to do a recording for us. But it was written, as far as we can trace, by Prince Oscar Bernadotte. I don't know how you pronounce it. In 1888, he relinquished his royal title. He married a commoner who had influenced his religious beliefs. And afterwards, he was active in Christian service. His poem, I'd Rather Have Jesus, was remodeled by Ray Miller, and a copy left on a piano at the home of the young George Beverly Shea. The poem inspired George and spoke to him of his own goals and ambitions. He sat at the piano and began singing the poem with a tune he composed then and there. George's life direction changed. He was offered a popular music career with NBC, but he chose to work with Billy Graham, and he sang this hymn around the world. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. We have this treasure in earthen pots. As Spike Milligan said, blessed are the cracked, for they let in and out the light. Let's pray. Let's just spend a moment dwelling on what the Lord has done for us, what the Lord is doing in us, and what the Lord wants to shine out from us. Thank you, Jesus, for all your work. Thank you for giving us your Spirit to dwell within. Thank you that though we are cracked and vulnerable and failing, yet your light somehow still shines and shines brightly. Nothing can put that out. Amen.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands. pierced hand. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. Fairer than lilies of rarest bloom, he's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than this world affords today.
Let us join together in saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now our prayers of intercession. Loving Father, you know our hearts and share our sorrows. We come before you today with heavy hearts at the loss of our dear sister Michelle. We thank you for all that was good in her life and for the times we shared with her. We thank you for the ways in which she served you in this place, for her laughter and for her dancing. We pray for her mum, June, her children, Piper, Alana, and William, for her sisters and her wider family and friends. We ask you to show the depths of your love to all who mourn. Come alongside us in our sadness and give us your peace and comfort for the days to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we lift to you the troubled places of the world and the people who live there. We ask for peace and justice to prevail everywhere. We ask you to help those whose lives have been devastated by recent floods and fires in various parts of the world. Please equip those tasked with tackling the problems caused by climate change with wisdom, and help us all to live responsibly and to play our part in preserving your world and its resources for the future. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. At this holiday time, we pray for safety for all who are travelling, and for rest and refreshment for those who are able to take a break from their usual routine. We pray for the staff and children of our local schools and from our preschool as they begin their summer holiday. Thank you for the sun and the refreshing rain, and for the beauty of our outside spaces at this time of year. Help us to always appreciate the little things and to set our priorities right. Most of all, help us to value and share the treasure we have in you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, be close to those who are ill, afraid, or in isolation at this time. In their anxiety, be their light. In their loneliness, be their consolation. We ask for healing for those recovering from accidents and surgery, and for those suffering the long-term effects of COVID. Thank you for the skill and dedication of doctors, nurses, and carers, and for the scientists researching new and more effective treatments. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, the God of righteousness and truth, grant to our Queen and her government, to members of Parliament, and to all in positions of responsibility, the guidance of your Spirit. May they never lead the nation wrongly through love of power, desire to please, or unworthy ideals, but always love righteousness and truth. So may your kingdom come and your name be hallowed through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lastly, a prayer of Saint Benedict. O gracious and holy Father, give us wisdom to perceive you, diligence to seek you, patience to wait for you, eyes to behold you, a heart to meditate upon you, and a life to proclaim you, through the power of the Spirit of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to join me in saying the collect for today. Almighty Lord and everlasting God, we beseech you to direct, sanctify, and govern both our hearts and bodies in the ways of your laws and the works of your commandments, that through your most mighty protection, both here and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now we can sing the song, Sing of the Lord's Goodness. Just a few notices to draw to your attention. Today is the first of our open gardens from 3 o'clock to 5 o'clock at Chris and Hillary's. They have set up a large gazebo and have large umbrellas, so it will go ahead whatever the weather decides to do this afternoon, and you will be most welcome there. Morning prayer on Zoom will take place on Monday and Wednesday at 9 o'clock this week with the usual codes. And there is still a need for donations of food and toiletries at the food drop-off here in the crypt on Wednesdays and Saturdays from 10 o'clock until 2 o'clock if you are able to help at all with that. Now we have our blessing, and after the music group have sung a song of blessing for us, I have to ask you to leave the church at the back, as we usually do, and to meet in the front for a chat if you would like to in the car park. The blessing. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face to shine on us and be gracious to us. May the Lord turn his face towards us and give us peace. Amen.